Amen. Jasmine, thank you for leading us into worship, and thanks to each of you for being here today. It's always a blessing to see live people here at the Bell Chapel. Welcome back to so many of you. Thank you for making worship part of your Sunday. I'm going to just let you know about a few distractions ahead of time. At any moment now, paddle boarders could be going by. That's part of the GoPro games, and they usually finish that up during our service. Feel free to cheer if you'd like. That's okay. Well, we might have a few people flying by there today. We have thousands of people who are in Bell this weekend for the Mountain Games. And I do want to thank you for making worship part of your life on Sunday. We're joining together as God's people, and it's always a blessing to be with you. Let's pray as we begin our time of worship. Heavenly Father, for the blessing of this day and for the occasion of your people joining together in worship, we give you praise and thanksgiving, and we ask that you suit a blessing, a special blessing, to each one present. Lord Jesus, touch us at our places of need. Draw our hearts and our minds closer to you. Open us up that we might worship you in spirit and in truth. May we receive your truth. May we receive the fellowship of believers. May we experience your grace in a powerful way today. And Lord, may your people rejoice. For this is the day that you have made, and we will rejoice and be glad in this, thanking you for the blessings of life and the opportunities together. Lord Jesus, we now say that you are welcome here. Come take control, take our hearts, our lives, direct us into the fullness of your grace, that your name might be lifted up throughout the land. For this time together, we thank you again in Jesus' name. Amen. Again, welcome. What a blessing. Number 343, if you need a hymn book, it's Amazing Grace. We're going to sing all the verses again. There's five verses. You might need it on verse 3 and 4. Those don't get sung all the time. But let's stand together as we sing and join our voice in worship. Amazing Grace 343.
Thank you.
seat just yet. One of our favorite things to do is to share the peace of Christ with each other. And we have to make up for the past couple of years when we were asked not to do this part of the worship. But as you feel comfortable shaking hands, greeting each other, feel free to bump fists if that's what you're comfortable with. You could even do a little toe tap. That's becoming more and more acceptable. Make eye contact with somebody and thank them for being here. Let them know you appreciate joining together in worship. So let's fellowship for a minute, greet each other in the Lord, and feel free to make a new friend if you'd like to as well. Let's fellowship for a bit. So I'm going to take this moment to greet those of y'all who are watching with us virtually right now as the fellowship continues here in the congregation. I hope this doesn't make anybody nauseated, but I'm going to turn this around so that you can see the people here in the chapel right now. We are beginning to fill up again, and people are returning for the summertime. And I know that many of you who are watching will probably be back up here shortly. So we're looking forward to seeing you when you get here, and we'll be sharing the peace of Christ again, and it's such a blessing to have you with us today. Great to have all of you here this morning. Thank you for giving us our cue, Jasmine, because sometimes we just don't know when to stop. It's always It is so good to see people sharing hearts and lives together again and welcoming each other into worship. We've missed that for such a long time. And it's a vital part of who we are. Because I say this frequently, while you're here with us, you leave a part of your heart behind. And we share that. And when you travel back home or to wherever your travels will take you, you take a part of our heart with you. And that's one of the ways we can stay joined together. And we really appreciate being able to share in fellowship. And thank you again for your hospitality towards each other this morning. In your bulletin, you'll see a sheet of paper like this. If you'd be kind enough to fill it out and drop it in the offering plate. We're still not passing a plate. It's on the table right back there. So as we leave, if you just drop this in there, it would give us a record of your attendance. And we always appreciate that. On the back is prayer requests. This is what we look forward to. How can we pray for you? How can we minister to you while you're here or away? And we'd certainly welcome that. As many of you know, our website has still crashed. We're hoping it's going to be back up by next Sunday. That was kind of the arrangement to have it ready by Father's Day. So until then, most of our communication comes out in our weekly email newsletter. I know many of you received that. If you don't and you would like to, please put your email address here and check the box and say, I'd like to get that. It usually comes out on Thursday or Friday, and we would love to send that to you and help keep you in touch with all the activities going on here in Vail. As you walked past the green fencing this morning, you realize that we are still a construction zone and will be through until Thanksgiving this year. So we're having to deal with that, but there's not going to be construction on Sunday. We're going to be live for worship all the way up until October for sure. And we're going to start seeing some transformation down here next to the river with a new patio going in, a lot of new gardens going in, the beautification of the south side of the property. Back behind us, there's going to be an outdoor worship area built, which can also serve as an outdoor wedding venue as well. And I'm hoping that in September, weather permitting, we can actually have a service outside next to the river. That should be done by that time, and I think that would be kind of fun, because when you're in Vail, don't you really want to be outside anyway? It'll be a great time there. Keep that in mind as we're thinking about it. And one fair warning for everybody, just a piece of advertisement here. If you haven't thought about this yet, next Sunday is Father's Day. Put that in the back of your mind and be planning that direction. As we do on Mother's Day, we celebrate moms, but we indeed celebrate all ladies because God has blessed us with females. And it's just a wonderful time to cherish and thank each other. We'll do the same thing with the men next week. Dads, grandpas, which I am one now. If you didn't know, I'll be happy to tell you about that and show you tons of pictures. Not that I'm counting, but 17 weeks today. And she was born during church on Sunday, February the 6th. I cut the sermon short. It was in the Beaver Creek service. My phone started buzzing about 15 minutes into the sermon. It was a good sermon, y'all. But when that phone started buzzing, it took priority. And hopefully we'll get her up here this summer and be able to share live, but it's a good time. But we're going to celebrate men next week, so I hope you'll be here with us for that. Our scripture passage today is found in the book of 2 Corinthians. A powerful truth. The church at Corinth had its share of difficulties. And the difficulty that Paul is addressing primarily in 2 Corinthians is the difficulty of false teachers. There was a group of people who were trying to lead people astray from the gospel by adding to it the law. They later received the name Judaizers. And here's how that would go. Who's going to volunteer for me this morning, Bus? Great, thank you. What the plan of attack was is in worship service, they would come and go, you love the Lord, don't you?
Yes.
You want to grow in your Christian faith. You want to be the man that God wants you to be. And we're here to help you. If you take, the Old Testament came first, remember? And if we take the teachings of the Old Testament and train you in the law, plus what you know about Christ, your life will explode with spirituality. That doesn't sound too bad, does it? Until you think about what's really being said. And they were adding the law back to the life of Christ. We were set free from the law, from the first covenant. And it was a group, these false teachers were tearing churches apart. Paul was writing to them, and he talks about the covenant that was given to Moses and how it's not near the new covenant. Now, if the ministry that brought death, which is engraved on letters of stone, came with glory so that the Israelites could not even look at the face of Moses because of its glory, fading though it was, will not the ministry of the Spirit be even more glorious? If the ministry that condemns people is glorious, how much more glorious is the ministry that brings righteousness? For what was glorious now has no glory at all in comparison to the surpassing glory of the new covenant. And if what was fading away came with glory, how much greater is the glory of that which lasts for eternity? Therefore, since we have hope, we are very bold. We are not like Moses, who put a veil over his face to keep Israel from glazing on it while the radiance was fading away. But their minds were made dull, for to this day the same veil remains when the old covenant is read. The veil has not been removed, because only Christ can take that away. Even to this day, when Moses is read, a veil covers their hearts. But when anyone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. Now the Lord is Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And we, who with unveiled faces all reflect the Lord's glory, we are all being transformed into his likeness with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Holy Spirit. We pray the Lord will add his blessings to the reading of his word. I'm excited about this passage today, y'all. We're going to have a good time in just a moment. Before we get there, we're going to sing again hymn number 589. Here I am, Lord. Hymn number 589. Again, let's stand together, and Jasmine will lead us. Thank you. So as we go to our Lord in prayer at this time, you'll see the Lord's Prayer printed for you in the bulletin. We'll close this time by saying the Lord's Prayer together. But now I invite you to bow with me as we approach the throne of grace. Heavenly Father, again, your people, we humble ourselves and come before you thanking you for this day, for this time of worship, for the fellowship of believers and the communion of saints. And Lord Jesus, above all, for your Spirit that binds the hearts of your people together. Not filling just a room, but individuals, uniting us in Christ and calling us as family. And Lord, how we celebrate you and cherish this today as we worship together. Your people pray, Lord Jesus, that this will be a time of celebration, a time of acknowledging you as our King of Kings and Lord of Lords, our Savior, our Maker and Creator, our Redeemer. Lord, let us celebrate you well. Let us cherish this time. And we also pray that you keep us mindful of so many who are hurting, thanking you for the privilege of praying for those in need, for those who are struggling with illnesses, injuries, brokenness. Father, we pray your physical touch upon so many. We pray that you would restore bodies into the way that they were made and bless them. Lord, for those who mourn, struggling with depression or doubt, grief and loss, we thank you again for your word where you tell us you bind up those with broken hearts and you will not break a bruised reed. But in humility, you offer peace in place of chaos and restore and renew the spirits and the emotions of your people. And we pray that you let that be so today in our midst. Father, we pray for a spiritual healing as well, one where lives are renewed and challenged, one where we look to you as the author and perfecter of our faith. And Lord, we ask now for a spiritual healing, not only upon us, but upon our land and upon our world. We know that every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. We pray that that begins in this moment with the lives of your people here, filling each one who calls upon you. Bless this worship. Open our hearts that we might receive your truth and live in fullness of life. And now let your people join together and let us pray the way that you have taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. So as we look into God's word today, you will see the title of today's, well, you won't see it. I've got it here on my notes, but you don't. The title of today's message is The Yes Face of Christ. What we saw contrasted here was the difference between the Old Covenant and the New Covenant. And just to give us a refresher course in some history, when Moses led God's people out of Egypt, when they were in the wilderness, God gave them the Ten Commandments. Moses went up onto Mount Sinai, was actually in the presence of God, and received the Ten Commandments for the people of Israel. And when he came down, his face glowed. It was bright. It was shining, so much so that the people were in awe of the way Moses looked, because he had been in the presence of God. And Moses put a covering about his face. First of all, so the people would be able to hear the law and not be focused on him. But secondly, the Shekinah glory of God was fading, little by little. And not wanting to see the glory fade, it remained covered. God's word teaches us that the law was given to bring us to the Messiah, to our Savior. It's a schoolmaster, a teacher. And that ministry had glory with it, but that glory faded. And as that glory faded, it became more and more evident that when the Messiah would come, the glory of that covenant, the new covenant, would be even more radiant, and there would be no fading with that, because it is living, active, and personal through each one of us. Paul is doing that because you can't add to the gospel. When we add to the gospel or take away from it, we lessen the power of God in some capacity and take it back and put it on ourselves. So in doing this, he's setting up the reason that we have this hope. The reason we have this is because of what God is doing now. Therefore, since we have such a hope, we are very bold. We are not like Moses, who would put a veil over his face to keep Israel from gazing at it while the radiance was fading away. But their minds were made dull, for to this day the same veil remains on the old covenant. It's removed through the Spirit of Christ, and the face makes that evident. I want to read a story to you that was written in a book by Charles Swindoll. He did not make this story up. It's a tradition that's passed down from generations. During Thomas Jefferson's presidency, he and a group of travelers were crossing a river that had overflown its banks. Each man crossed on horseback, fighting for their lives in the currents. There was one lone traveler who watched the group traverse the treacherous river and then asked President Jefferson to take him across. The president agreed without hesitation. So the man climbed on and the two made it safely to the other side of the river, where one of the other men said, "Why did you just ask the President of the United States to give you a ride across the river?" The man was shocked, admitting he had no idea this was the president who had carried him across. "All I know," he said, "that as I looked on some of your faces, well, there was written the answer, no. And on some of them, their face said, yes." And he had a yes face. Have you ever seen a yes face? I believe we've all seen a yes face. I believe we've all seen a no face before. Who are we generally more attracted to? We all kind of like yes faces. They're a little more welcoming. They're inviting. They're encouraging. President Jefferson had that yes face. And this story speaks about this particular passage of Scripture. For in Moses' face, the glory was dwindling, and the yes was slowly becoming no. But in Christ, we portray the radiance of grace, which produces a yes face. And then Charles Swindoll added one of my favorite parts to this. He said, "The most significant decision I make each day is me making the choice of what my attitude will be. When my attitudes are right, there's no barrier too high, no valley too deep, no dream too extreme, and no challenge too great." To me, that is the definition of a yes face. It's a face that's filled with the glory of God. It's a face that says we will face this life and overcome this through Christ our Lord. Now the people were troubled. They were in the midst of chaos. False teachers were seeking to lead believers astray, telling them that they had to add the law back to their life. And Paul says, wait a second. If the ministry, the law condemns mankind, if that had glory, what about the law? What about the ministry that brings righteousness? Won't that be more glorious? And the answer is, of course it will. It produces a yes face and a yes attitude in the lives of God's people. The old covenant has passed away, and it is now the new covenant. Last week we celebrated around the table with communion, and we talked a little bit about the cup of the new covenant. And I made this statement, and I try to do this almost every communion time. The new covenant is not the old covenant made better. The new covenant is new. It's different. The old covenant got us to there. The new covenant is what takes us home to heaven. Just this morning as we were setting up here in the chapel to get ready for worship service, the Lutherans were in here before us, and Pastor Scott was here. We were having a conversation, and we pastors tend to talk to each other from time to time. We kind of enjoy each other. I have great colleagues here. So I asked Pastor Scott, I said, Scott, has anything in your life slowed down over the past month? Because he's had a very busy and hectic 6 months this year. He said, well, a lot slowed down this week. My car blew a cylinder. Only had 340,000 miles on my Honda. And it's got a pinhole leak in one of the cylinders, and I took it into the shop, and they said, well, you can putz around town, but you're not getting back over the pass anymore. So he did what we would all do. What's it going to cost to fix that? And it didn't take the mechanics long to go, you know, by the time we get a new engine for your car that's 13 years old, and all the other parts have 320,000 miles on them too, that new engine is going to cost double what your car is worth. Time to get a new one. That's the way it is with the new covenant. The old covenant had a lot of mileage on it. It had blown some cylinders. It had fulfilled its purpose and found that fulfillment in the person of Christ. The new covenant sets us up for eternity. Not just looking for the Messiah, living with the Messiah. And therefore we have this hope. We're not like Moses. We're not going to cover our faces. The radiance is not going to fade away because it comes from the glory of God. Because only Christ can take that away. Even to this day when Moses is read, a veil covers their hearts. The truth is not revealed. But whenever anyone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away, and now the Lord is Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And this is what God desires for His people to know today, that there is freedom in Christ. And because of that, we live from glory into glory, into greater glory for the worship of our God. I made a confession this morning over in Beaver Creek, and I'm going to do the same thing here. I'm going to be a little more vague, though, because we are recording the service. This has not been a good week for my family. It's been filled with trials and tribulations. I have seen more EMTs and policemen than I care to see in a week. We have dealt with more addiction issues, hatred, and anger than we would care to see in a week. We've seen more doubt and hostility than anyone would care to see in a week. And I can't tell you how glad I am just to be here today. It's been one of those. What this message tells me, I lived this week, and it's amazing what God did in the midst of all this. My life coach sent me an email. Oh, it happens to be based on the passage of Scripture we just read. just happened to do that, talking about how we can live a reminder on life that is fulfilling to the glory of our God. But I know a lot of you have had difficult weeks as well. And this is not a comparison to see who had the worst week. But what I've learned in the midst of this past week and struggle and difficulty is that I found again a new level of need in my own heart for God's Holy Spirit to touch, move, and grow me. Because I faced questions I can't answer. Facing situations I can't understand. And then I get this beautiful email from my life coach. And I don't know if anybody will be able to read it from that far away. And I know on the camera you can't read it. So I'm just going to tell you. There are three letters up here. S-F-T. It's a reminder for leadership performance. Has anyone ever heard those three letters? With leadership performance, SFT. I'll just tell you what they are. You don't have to try to guess. The S is see it. The F is feel it. And the T is trust it. When we look at our lives, when we have to look and see our existence, it's not always a bed of roses. It's not always perfect. It's not always where we want it to be. We see the uglinesses as well. And we live there. We see the beauty. We see the ugly. We see the good. We see the bad. We see the graciousness. We see the hatred. All of that is part of who we, what we see. And we feel those things. I was talked to this past week with words and attitude that I will never repeat. And the heart breaks and says, how can we help? And I hate not having an answer to that question. But the Spirit of God worked in my heart this week, and my wife, all of us together, to go, sometimes the answer is, we need to depend on His Spirit even more than we thought capable or possible. We felt it. Still feeling it. And then the T is trust it. Do we have any golfers here? I've got to break this up a little bit. We have golfers, get your hands up. Thank you. I love those of us who play a game that nobody can ever win. It just it's designed to humble us and make us pray more. And as I told the folks in Beaver Creek, the Apostle Paul was the first golfer mentioned in Scripture. When we read the book of Romans and he goes, I see my life before me and the things I want to do, I don't do them. And the things I don't want to do, yep, that's what happens. And haven't we all done that? I want to hit that ball straight down the fairway and it goes left. So I aim left and it goes way right. And then I line up right and it goes straight, but I wasn't aiming there, so it still messes up. He wasn't really a golfer, but I heard a commentary on that one time and I thought it was very appropriate. The things I want to do, I'm not doing them. The things I want to avoid, they just keep happening. And he finally goes, what a wretched person I am. Who can deliver me from this evil? And he's talking in a spiritual realm at that point. And he says, praise be to God who gives us victory over our struggles in Christ Jesus our Lord. The person who wrote this particular guide used this as a golf training tool and as a Bible teaching tool. See it. See your life for what it really is. Feel it. Embrace it. Knowing the good and the bad. And then trust it. When I took up that nasty habit of golfing as a teenager, my home course in Canton, Georgia was only a 9-hole course, and there was water on 5 of the 9 holes. The first hole was a short par 5. I say easily reachable in 2, it was usually 4, but it was still easily reachable in 2. The second hole, the short par 3, went across a raging creek. It was a 165-yard carry. If you got over the creek, you're pretty much okay. I played that course many times. I'd put the new ball on a tee on number 1, hit it, try not to lose it, get there, come up to hole number 2, pull the most dirty, rotten ball out of my bag, tee it up to get ready to hit over the creek. And one day a man came to me. He was one of our club pros. He goes, "Tim, why do you pull out the worst bat ball in your bag on hole number 2? I said, "Well, there's a creek up there. I'm probably going to knock it in it." He goes, "You've already admitted defeat when you went to the old ball. It'd be a miracle if you actually got it across because you've already said you can't. Can you hit the ball 165 yards? I said, "I can't." He said, "Go right down the fairway. Hit it," because it was right next to the number 1 fairway. He said, hit backwards. We'll go pick it up." I hit 160. He goes, "Hit that. Hit it again." I put 3 balls in the fairway. He goes, "Now turn this way and knock the ball across the creek." And that was the moment I had to learn to trust that swing in action. Brothers and sisters, we have to trust our lives in action. There are times we come up to the impossible situation, but with the attitude of the yes face, no barrier is too tall, no valley too deep. And that's what Paul is saying, that's what God is telling us right here. "Now the Lord is Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, not bondage, not death, not despair." The yes face of God saying, "We are who we are. See our truth. Who are we? What do we see in our own lives?" I'm not asking you to say these things out loud. Seeing God's truth that gives us freedom. I'm looking at you this morning. You know what I see? We got a whole lot of righteousness sitting right over here because God tells me you're the righteousness of Christ. We got a whole lot of faithfulness over here on this side because the faith of God's Spirit is working in us. We got a whole lot of family here today from different states and different backgrounds because we've been adopted into the family of God. We've been filled with the same Holy Spirit. I see the face of Christ sitting in the pew. Do we struggle with that truth? I'm going to quote the great theological movie that I love to quote, one of my 5 all-time favorites that I can usually go through almost verbatim. It's that epic theological great movie called Pretty Woman, with Julia Roberts and Richard Gere. And there's a scene in there where they're talking. And he looks at her and goes, "You have so much potential." And she says, "When people put you down long enough, you start to believe it." To which he replies, "But you are so much more than that." And this is the line I cry every time I hear it. She looks at him and says, "The bad stuff is easier to believe." Why is that true? Because it appeals to the sinful nature. We know we've sinned. We know we've fallen short. We struggle with our own self-worthiness. We struggle with the fact that God loves us that much. The bad stuff is easier to believe. List off all the good things you've done this past week and list off the parts you think are failures, and guess which list is going to be bigger? But the truth is, God sees you as His people. He sees us as His people. See it. Live in that truth. Feel it. And entrust it with life in action. And when that raging river of life overflows, and we're looking for that yes face, Jesus puts us on the horse with Him and takes us through the raging rivers of life to the promised land. And we who are all with unveiled faces, listen to this truth, we all reflect God's glory. We're all a reflection of God's glory. And we are being transformed into His likeness with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. See it. Feel it. Trust it. God tells us how many times, don't be afraid. Don't live in fear. He came to give life and give it abundantly. Nothing can separate us from the love of Christ. We are new creatures. The old is gone. Whew. And still we struggle because the bad stuff's still easier to believe. That's why we have church. We don't have worship so you'll have something to do on Sunday morning at 11 o'clock. Some people are shocked by that one, but we don't have church for that reason. We need the fellowship of believers because each of us in our day-to-day life struggle with these very truths, and what better place can we give each other encouragement? Up on vacation, you happened to come to church this morning. Thank you so much. Your faithfulness is speaking volumes right now. I'm not going to look over there because I'll cry, but married almost a year, sitting next to each other again and seeing those smiling faces that I saw right up here last year. Testimony to God's glory. Live that, feel that, trust that. Let that be part of who we are as God's people. We are in this process of being transformed, and we're in that process together. So we get to give encouragement. We get to give some hope. We get to hold a hand when life is rotten. Because life isn't always the way we want it to be. But the grace of God is always what we need in every situation. And in the midst of the week that our families endured, I am thankful to our God that He had a special hold on the hearts of us this week to get us through. To let us fellowship here this day. It is my hope and prayer that as we're gathered here today, that this time together is where we see the yes face of God. Yes, you are dearly loved. Yes, you are cherished. Yes, you are righteousness. Yes, Christ loved you and died for us. Yes, yes, yes. For all eternity, from glory into glory. Trust it. That's the calling He's placed on us. Pray with me this morning. Heavenly Father, I feel a little bit like the man who brought a son to you that was possessed of a spirit asking, if you can do anything, have mercy on us. Lord, this morning, we trust you. Let your people trust you more. Let us give up the addiction of self for the filling and power of your Holy Spirit. And let your life be the one that we see in its fullness. And yea, though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we will not fear that evil, for you are with us. The good, the bad, the ugly, and the beautiful. And Lord Jesus, your people thank you this day for that gift. And we thank you that we're in this transformational process together. Bless your people. Guard our hearts and lives. Teach us and let us receive that truth and live in the fullness of the power of Christ. We pray this blessing upon each in Jesus' name. Amen. Again, we want to thank you for being with us this morning and for sharing your hearts and lives in worship. There's one quick announcement. I always love making this announcement, especially in the summertime. If any of you drove here today and you parked in the parking lot, anybody park in the parking lot today? Okay. We have a unique blessing that the Presbyterians, we're the only ones that get it in the summer. The Catholics don't show up for 3.5 hours, y'all. So if you've left your car here, you can leave it here, go have some lunch. Starting next week, I'll say go through the farmer's market, pick out some fruits and vegetables, enjoy Vail. Just have your car out by 3:30 so the Catholics can come in for their time of worship. If you didn't bring your car and you parked somewhere else, I hope you didn't pay for it. But if you are, learn your lesson next time. Park here. And then leave it here for 3 hours and go enjoy the town a little bit. And nobody else gets that one. So please take advantage of it. And look forward to seeing you again. Hope you're with us next week or whenever your travels or your life might bring you back up to the Vail area. It is indeed a blessing to be with you today. I pray now that God, our Heavenly Father, will bless you and keep you. I pray that he'll make his face to smile upon you. And he will direct our paths unto his righteousness for his honor and glory. And that we will be transformed into the image, into the glory of our God. From glory to glory for all eternity. With faces unveiled, let us be the yes face of God to a world that needs that. Go and be blessed. Go and be a blessing. I pray this upon you in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. God's blessings upon you. Hopefully you filled out the sheets, plates right back there. If you drop that in, we'd really appreciate it. Go in the peace of Christ. Have a wonderful day. Come and see us again real soon. God's blessings on you.